So I'm going to start first off by, I put an offering here, sage, to honor this territory that we're standing on, the original people whose bones are here. So, miasin, bonafita gisagao kakio. Good evening, everybody. Dante, hose, esquatame, fetagwe, kuo, squatame, wewe. So, from that doorway in to the doorway out. Nia crystal layman, amisksagehgan, nihio, piagoskan, wostesimao, woyosiwiwin, negotasik. I'm Crystal Lameman, Beaver Lake Cree Nation, Treaty Number 6, what is now known as Alberta, Canada. Ntataminan, Yiniwak of this territory. I'm thankful and I'm grateful to the people, the original people of this territory, that I could be here. I'm going to try to, normally I have myself very set up, but after a conversation that I had yesterday on the way here, I really had to change things around, because normally, you know, I go into these spaces where it's people who are there for the, you know, the environmental reasons. They know why I'm there, I realized that this is a different setting, and so I wanna start by acknowledging, you know, that we're here, first of all, together, and we're looking beyond the confines of race, color, and creed, and, you know, here the pieces of a perfect solidarity puzzle. So I'm going to try my best to tell a reality, not a story. I wish it were a story, because then it might not be true. So as I sat this morning and I listened to those men on that TV, you know, I know their reality all too well. I come from parents who succumbed to those cyclical and systemic issues of the colonization of our people. I have a mother who lost herself out there on the streets. And siblings that did the same, and a father that did the same. But I can say, you know, losing my mom to this, as an earthly being, you know, I still have my dad, and I'm grateful for that. You know, growing up without my mom, she left when I was 7, and she didn't look back. And I put her to rest when I was 25. I had just had my first child. And as I got involved in this work, the work of our one true mother, I used to cry a lot. I still cry. Because I don't know what it feels like to grow up with a mom. I had my grandma, my grandmother. She brought me up. But to know that love of a mother, I don't know anything about that. And my uncle, he had told me one time recently, a couple of years ago. He told me, that's my daughter. As long as you have our mother, you'll always have a mom. And so this work that you're doing for our one true mother, that's the work you're doing for your mom. And so when people question why I do the work that I do, I talk about sacrifice. And it's not even sacrifice, that's the wrong word to use, but that's the thing about this English language. There's just, it's very hard to describe things. It's not a sacrifice, but that's the best word that I could come up with in doing this work. But as a mother, you know, and as a woman who, you know, wants that connection to her mother, you know, that's one of the reasons why, you know, we fight so hard. So some of these I'm just going to go through. Like I said, I switched everything at the last minute. This is the Alberta tar sands. So I come from a place where the Indigenous people are faced with a government and an industry that will stop at nothing to get the bitumen to the out of the ground, and at whatever cost. And so what you see there is there's three deposit areas in Alberta, and this red line, red spot here is where the open pit mining happens. That's the pictures a lot of people see. Out of the 100% of tar sands in Alberta, only 20% of that can be extracted using the open pit mining. The rest of it is done through a process called steam-assisted gravity drainage, SAGD or in situ, where you know essentially they pump water, high-pressured steam into the ground. So it's steam in, bitumen out. And my nation is located in between two of those three tar sands deposit areas. So that's it. Today is gold. Just like gold, you know, oil and gas is a dying economy with a current lifespan of 50 to 100 years to bring the types of returns we're seeking currently, because it's declining and it's a dying economy. But a dying economy that's taking a real toll on the lives and the ecosystems of the Indigenous people. And it's not only the Indigenous people, because in our traditional territory, we have non-Indigenous people. We have farmers, we have ranchers. And but as First Nations people living on the front lines of this economy, I talk about it in that sense because I can't talk about it as a farmer or a rancher because I'm not. And so there you see it, bitumen is a mixture of oil, clay, sand, and water. And that's what everyone's going crazy over right now. So when we talk about being on the front lines, so we believe in the life-giving abilities of our one true mother, and we believe that with our truth-telling abilities, we will be able to move forward in a better way of knowing and being. So Article 32 of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples states that Indigenous peoples have the right to determine and develop priorities and strategies for the development or use of their lands or territories and other resources. And so what we utilize that, you know, in talking about how, you know, it's crucial to raise the platform on the rights of Indigenous peoples under these states, because in my homeland, beyond that invisible border, in that state we call Canada, we're facing a government that has completely dismantled environmental protections by ways of Omnibus Bill C-38, shortening the time frame for environmental assessments with greater federal control. Bill C-38 was quickly followed by Omnibus Bill C-45, amounting to a First Nations land grab, and the complete erasure of virtually all legal protections of our surface freshwater systems. And that was followed by Bill S-8, which the federal government supposedly enacted to provide safe drinking water to First Nations people. In reality, it will result in the privatization of our water, taking the milk of our mother and turning it into a commodity. And then from there, when you talk about the Canadian government pulling out of the Kyoto Protocol, signing FIPA with China. And so here is where we talk about how these governments have created their laws. These are their laws. Because as Indigenous people, we abide by natural law, and there's nothing natural about a people dying from cancer and suffering from respiratory illnesses. But they don't get to pick the pieces of their law they like and which ones they don't. They made their law, so they have to abide by it. But here is an example of how they get to take their law and do what they please with it. Commodifying the milk of our mother. The milk of our mother, that water that has life-giving abilities. So the commodification of resources like oil and gas is the commodification of Mother Earth. And it's taken us down this path of losing ourselves, and we can no longer perpetuate the oil and gas sector. And I'm not saying that we cannot engage in industrial development, but what I am saying is not to do it in the name of raping and pillaging of our mother and further violating basic human rights, which is further perpetuating the violence against women and the violence against our mother. And this is not about the economy versus the environment. This has and always will be about the health and longevity of our Mother Earth and recognizing that she has rights too. So when I look at the beauty of our land and our culture, that's my son, Gray Sky. Our relationship with our one true mother, it reminds me of the fact that we're drinking bottled water. You know, my uncle, he talks about that time. He said in the 80s, you know, he was sitting at an all chiefs gathering. He was a leader in our community. He was sitting at an all chiefs gathering, and he kind of leaned back in his chair and he said, you know, there's going to come a time and day that we're going to have to buy our water to drink. And they laughed at him. And here we are in that time. And those of you that live in the state of California, you know all too well about that. I'm reminded of the fact that we're drinking bottled water, that we're airlifting our babies to the hospitals for drinking contaminated water. Cancer rates and respiratory illnesses are on the rise. Boil water advisories. Moose with pus bubbles under the skin. Deer with green meat. Fish with tumors hanging off of them. That's not a story. That's a reality. Indigenous people living in a first world country, but succumb to third world living conditions. And the reality that the land, that's our Bible, that's our religion. If we don't have that, if we don't have clean berries, if we don't have clean water, if we don't have clean medicines, we lose who we are. And I fear, you know, that the stories of our old people skimming the top of the water and taking their backpack from their dipper from their backpack and drinking that water. They talk about it, that was the cleanest water that they have ever tasted. That when they would go into the muskeg to go and pick medicine, they would pull the muskeg, the moss from the ground. And they would go off and they would go and pick and they would come back and that hole would be full of water. And my kukum would take her handkerchief from her head and put that handkerchief in there to strain the water and they would drink that water. And I fear that that's going to be just that, a story. A story that my children and our future generations can only hear of and never experience. And I'm a little luckier than most because the atrocities I experienced as a child and the abuses that I witnessed and was a part of, the sexual abuse, the physical abuse, the mental, emotional, and spiritual abuse, they were a blessing in disguise because had Nochkum, had my grandmother not taken me from my parents that time, I wouldn't have been raised so close to the land. And I wouldn't understand that connection that we have as Indigenous people to the land. And as a young person, I was one of those young people that was ignorant. And I knew everything. And I remember laying in my bed as a teenager. You know, teenagers, all they want to do is sleep. And I'm lucky. I live in my community. And so these frogs, they would just be making so much noise. And you know, we live in an old house, so, you know, and an old people, they don't believe in air conditioners or anything like that. Yes, it gets hot in northern Alberta. And I would slam the window, and I would just roast to death in my room so that I could sleep because these frogs were so loud. And then as I got older, started to hear the story about the frogs and the teaching behind the frogs. And that the frogs will be where it's clean. and that they'll be the first ones to leave when someplace becomes dirty. And so when I left an abusive marriage in 2011 and I took my children and I went home, I remember laying with my children and the window was open and I didn't hear the frogs. That's not a story. The medicines that they talk about, the old people, that in their purest form at one time, combined with others in their purest form, could cure cancer. That's what our old people talk about. This is the traditional territory of the Beaver Lake Cree. That black line is the Alberta border, Alberta-Saskatchewan border. So you can see where the deposit areas, here's the red line here. These are the two deposit areas that are to our community falls within. And so the traditional territory of the Beaver Lake Cree spans 38,972 square kilometers of natural habitat. 34,773 square kilometers of that has been leased out. Without the Canadian government following due process and their duty to consult the First Nations people of that territory. Treaty 6. And so there you see every major oil company in the world within our traditional territory, the entirety of the tar sands deposit area is leased out. Sorry, overburden. that's a word that the government and industry likes to use. Since operations began, tar sands extractors have moved more than 1.4 billion tons of what industry calls overburden, which is actually pristine boreal forest. And this is more dirt than was moved for the Great Wall of China, the Suez Canal, the Great Pyramid of Cheops, and the 10 largest dams in the world. Combined. Tailings ponds, toxic sludge being leached into our waterways, water that we drink. And there's the SAGD that I was talking about. And the government, you know, they like to parade around and they come into countries like yours and they try to sell tar sands. And we're moving away from open pit mining because everybody's focused on the open pit mining. You guys need to stop the open pit mining. But we're doing this thing called SAGD, which is actually more environmentally friendly because it's what the eye can't see. But science says that it leaves a larger environmental footprint than surface mining. And 80% of the recoverable tar sands deposits need to be extracted through in situ. SAGD has a larger environmental footprint than open pit mines. So there's an above ground view. And here's an aerial shot. And this next slide is going to show a simulation of the future development footprint based on existing leases. And that, again, there again, in the traditional territory of the Beaver Lake Cree, all of that is pipelines. The animals won't cross over that. It's foreign to them. The black dots are pipeline spills. I got to go through all this. Sorry, I was going to, you know, talk about science, those fancy words. We don't have time for that. So here is a glimpse into the trials and tribulations that we're facing, a people challenged by the strong arm of industry and their willful ignorance that follows. Where on May 20th of 2013, two oil spills were reported on the Canadian Natural Resources Limited lease pads that are located on the Cold Lake Air Weapons Range in northern Alberta. Two more reports were followed after that. So four spills that as of today, some 16 months later, have not been proven to be contained. Over 1.5 milliliters of bitumen emulsion, which is basically water mixed with toxic chemicals and bitumen spilling onto the land. There's no way to stop it, and yet that same company is submitting applications to begin re-steaming, and they're being approved. And so here we are, you know, if we don't deal with this current system of economic development, we're only going to end up going down that path that has no reverse. And it's time that we take a step back and evaluate what we're doing and we can take examples from our own lives as teachings, like that man in that video who talked about taking a step back. You know, I think about it, and it prompted me to think, had my mom been taught to take a step back, to be comfortable in her own skin through all of the abuses that she endured, she might still be here today. She might not have succumbed to the cyclical abuses of addiction. She might not have ended up on the streets selling her body, injecting herself with toxicity, becoming incarcerated, and ultimately drinking herself to death. And so it's time that we start taking a step back and reevaluating and assessing what we're doing. And I didn't come here to sell you anything, but I came here to tell you the truth. Speaking the truth. And the truth of the matter is that people are dying. Water life and land life, air life is dying in the name of industrialization of our traditional territories, a system ignoring our original jurisdiction and our right to self-determination. But there's one thing that we have in this movement that industry and government will never have, and that's our ability to tell the truth. As an Indigenous woman, you know, we're brought up, those of us that are lucky enough anyways, but because of the systems of colonization, you know, some of us have not had that luxury of being brought up around old people. But I was brought up with that teaching that as women, we are keepers of the water. It's not by chance that women carry life in water. Water has life-giving abilities, and that's one thing in this world that connects each and every human being, water. And so every once in a while, I'll go down to my nation's lake, to Beaver Lake, and I'll go and I'll put an offering in that water. And I went there, and I was sitting there, and I happened to look down, and I said, holy shit, Crystal, this is where the water line was when you were a kid. And then I took my children up to the healing walk in the open pit mining, where just not far from there, a few minutes, is a community, a First Nations community. And so that mask is no joke. The air is that toxic up there. And so here we have what was once pristine boreal forest. Every single thing that a human being needed to survive was right there. And now it's the Sahara Desert in northern Alberta. And I took my children there thinking I was going to do something good for them. Because I try to take them away from, I don't let them go to big marches and big rallies like I was just in New York recently for the People's Climate March. I don't take them to things like that. But I took them here because it was grounded in ceremony. And my son, on his fifth birthday, got a bleeding nose and he got sick and my niece had an asthma attack. And that's something that I have to carry with myself, that I did that to them. That's reclamation. The Beaver Lake Cree has embarked on a historically precedent-setting litigation, utilizing their treaty and Aboriginal rights. First Nations rights being the last remaining stronghold for environmental protection. But those are my children. And, you know, one of my mentors, I'm lucky enough, is Winona LaDuke. And I asked her one time, you know, I've got to go and speak to these people. I said, they don't know anything about tar sands. So what can I tell them to make them understand? And make them understand the rights of Indigenous peoples and how powerful they are being enshrined in the Canadian Constitution under Section 35 and how the Beaver Lake Cree has set historical precedents and how we are currently winning this litigation. She said, you just tell them to stop doing stupid stuff. Okay? You know, we need a moratorium on fossil fuel extraction and exploration, and we need to stop wasting time and money and do the right thing. And finally grow traditional foods and grow smart. And then she said, yes, it's that easy. And so, before your feet touch the floor in the morning, we're all human beings first and foremost. And when we go about things in a good way, with good intentions, Xaymanto, our creator, will never leave us vulnerable. But we will be tested. But it's how we respond to those tests that matter. And when I look at my children, and the fact that I leave them so much to carry out this responsibility as a woman and as a mother, I ask myself, when did it become okay that our mothers had to leave their children to protect their basic human rights, to drink clean water and breathe clean air, and to protect those next seven generations? When did it become okay that we had to choose our ways of knowing and being over feeding our families? And so wherever you are, when you leave from here, wherever you are, wherever you go to, demand systems that are founded and based on the rights of nature, the rights of human beings, the rights of those beings that cannot speak for themselves, and the ability to sustain ourselves. And so I'm going to leave you with this, and it comes from the Lakota people. Honor those who came before us, meeting the needs of the present generations, not compromising the future so that the coming generations are able to meet their own needs and guide our vision and renew each cycle of life. Love is the movement.